truly our God is a great God. We can always run to Him. He's a strong tower. He's the banner over our heads. And so we find protection and strength in Him. So as we get into our Bible study, I know it's been a long week. And the portion we covered last time was also pretty large compared to what we usually do. And so we'll have a quick summary. And I have asked Roshni to bring the summary. So over to you, Roshni.
Thank you, Achin. Good evening, everyone. The Bible study for last week was from Acts chapter 17, verse 15 to Acts chapter 18, verse 22. Please open your Bibles to Acts chapter 17, verse 15. We will have a quick run-through of what we had studied last week. We saw about Paul's missionary journey to Athens, Corinth, and Ephesus. First, let us see about the city of Athens. Athens was the capital of Greece. It was the birthplace of European civilization. It was also known as the city of idols. Athens was the intellectual, philosophical, academic, and cultural capital of the world. The Greeks had always boasted in the fact that they were great thinkers and philosophers. We saw how Paul had a very challenging set of audience. His audience in Athens can be categorized into four sets. In verse 17, we see that Paul was in the synagogue with the Jews and the God-fearing Greeks. The second set of people were the people in the marketplace. In verse 18, we see the third and the fourth set of people. They were the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers who began to debate with Paul. The Epicureans were atheists. They denied God and didn't believe in any God. Whereas the Stoic philosophers were pantheists, which means they believed in God and they had more than one God. So these were the four sets of people Paul was dealing with, and his sermon had to be appealing to his audience. In verse 19, we see that Paul was taken to a place called Areopagus. Areopagus was like the Supreme Court of the Athenians. It was also a place where religion, philosophy, and law was discussed. They considered Paul as a thinker who is there to advocate a new philosophy, and that is why he is called. We see in verse 23 on how he approaches his audience with his message about an inscription found on one of their altars which said, "To an unknown God." He presents a sermon on telling them about who that unknown God is. In verse 24 and 25, Paul talks about God as the creator and his omnipresence, that God is all-sufficient and he is the author of everything. In verse 26 and 27, Paul stresses again that God is sovereign. In verse 28, he goes on to say that this God dwells in us. This was a new thought for the philosophers, especially the Epicureans who didn't believe in God. And in verse 30, he mentions about how our God is a forgiving God. In verse 31, he also mentions about the judgment day that we will all face, where we are all called to be accountable for our actions. In verse 32, Paul finishes with the greatest event, that is the resurrection of Jesus. In verse 34, we see how the people in Athens responded to the gospel. Some became followers of Paul and they believed. They found the gospel to be above all their philosophies and beliefs. In particular, we see about two names that were being mentioned, Dionysus, who was the member of the Areopagus, and Damaris, who was a woman. With that, we end with Acts chapter 17. In Acts chapter 18, we see about Paul's missionary journey to Corinth and Ephesus. The city of Corinth was an important trade city. There were two harbors in Corinth. They were the Cenchrea and Lycaon. There were 12 temples in the city, which portrays that it was a very religious city, but religious in the wrong sense. We saw about the famous temple of Aphrodite, which was built honoring the goddess, and that temple employed over 1,000 temple prostitutes. Corinth was known for their immorality. In Acts chapter 18, verses 1 to 3, we see about Paul's acquaintance with Aquila and Priscilla. They were Jews by origin, and they were natives of Pontus, but they lived in Italy. Paul stayed and worked with Aquila and Priscilla because he was a tent maker as they were. In verse 7, we see that Paul later moved to the house of Titius Justus, who was a worshipper of God. In verse 18, we see that Aquila and Priscilla were also traveling companions of Paul. They accompanied him when they sailed for Syria. Now let us see about what was Paul's ministry in Corinth. In Acts chapter 18, verse 4, we see that Paul continues to teach in the synagogue. In verse 5, we read that Paul was joined by Timothy and Silas. In verse 6, we read that when they rejected Paul's teachings, he shook off the dust from his garments and moved on to go and preach the gospel to the Gentiles. We also read about a prominent person named Crispus in verse 8. He was the synagogue leader. We see that his entire household believed in the Lord along with the many others in Corinth, and they were baptized. In verse 11, we read that Paul stayed in Corinth for 18 months teaching them the word of God. Paul was not just interested in preaching the gospel, but he also taught them about the word of God, which is the very foundation of our Christian life. It was during this time that he wrote the 1st and 2nd Thessalonians. In verses 12 to 17, we see that Paul was taken on a trial before Gallio, who was the Roman proconsul. In verse 14, we see that Gallio rejects the accusations of the Jews. We see an incident happen in verse 17 about the synagogue leader Sosthenes, who was beaten in front of the proconsul. The reason could be because Sosthenes believed in the gospel. This was very similar to the way they treated Jason in Thessalonica. Now we come to the last part of Paul's second missionary journey, where he travels to Ephesus. Ephesus is in Asia Minor. Paul is on his return journey. He has left Europe after his ministry there, and he has returned to Asia Minor. We understand that Paul stayed in Ephesus only for a week. In verse 18 and 19, we see that Aquila and Priscilla stayed back in Ephesus. In the next couple of verses, we read that Paul traveled back to Antioch via Caesarea. And that was the end of Paul's second missionary journey. The takeaway message from last week's Bible study is, mission is a teamwork. And when we say teamwork, we are all part of that team. We are not spectators in God's kingdom, but we are the key team players. So let us humble ourselves and ask God about our role in this team, and God will reveal it to us. Thank you, Achin. Over to you.
Thank you, Roshni, for, I know it was a long one, and to put all that together. Okay, so we have again a big portion today. We are doing the last part of Acts chapter 18, and then we are doing the complete, it's Acts chapter 19 verses 1 to 40, I mean that's up to 1941. So it's going to be a big passage. As we start every chapter, we go to this chart, and you realize now that we are in almost coming to the more, we've crossed the halfway mark, and we are progressing. And today, as Roshni shared the summary, she said that Paul completed his second missionary journey, that he came back to Antioch. And now we are in chapter 18, verse 23, from where Paul begins. Although it is written Ephesus, I would have rather preferred a title that Paul begins his third missionary journey. So Acts chapter 18, 19, 20, 21 is all about Paul's third missionary journey. Yeah, as you see here, Paul's third missionary journey starts exactly here and then goes up to chapter 21. So we're going to see some interesting things that happen here. So this is where we are in the chart. And as we come to the next chart, this is the year AD 54 to 57, which means Paul was in Antioch for a year. Although we stopped at Acts chapter 18, verse 22, where the second missionary journey ended, and we start the third missionary journey on the very next verse. But please remember that Paul was in Antioch for a year, and he begins his mission, third missionary journey after a year. So that's third missionary journey, and that's found in Acts chapter 19, 20, 21. It mentions that Paul was in Ephesus for 3 years. We'll look into that. And during this journey, we believe he wrote 1st and 2nd Corinthians, and he also wrote Romans. Okay, with this, we go on to an outline of Paul's third missionary journey. Just keep this as an outline for Paul's third missionary journey, which is from Acts chapter 18, verse 23 to Acts chapter 21, verse 17. Now, these are the 3 points that we will see. It's very interesting that Acts chapter 18 is just a bit of introduction, and the whole of Acts chapter 19 is Paul's ministry in Asia. And Acts chapter 20 is all about Paul's ministry in Europe. And then Acts chapter 21 is his return journey to Jerusalem. And you'll interestingly see that Paul is returning to Jerusalem. Okay. So just to give you an idea that if you look at the first thing, first missionary journey was all about Asia. If you remember, he started from Seleucia. He went to Salamis, Paphos, Antioch, Pisidia, then Iconium, Derbe, Lystra, and then he came back. So this whole area is Asia. Okay. So, but when you see the second missionary journey, the whole concentration, although he crossed through Asia, but we know that he was more keen on getting into, you know, the Macedonian call. You remember how he got the Macedonian call, and then he traveled. And Macedonia is Europe. And so he was in Philippi, Thessalonica, then he came down to Athens, and then Corinth, and then he went to Ephesus, we know. So Ephesus, of course, is Asia, but all this part is where you see Greece and all these area is Europe. So the second missionary journey was Europe. Now, why I brought both these charts is for you to have a clear understanding that Paul's first missionary journey was basically Asia. His second missionary journey was Europe. So what do you think will be Paul's third missionary journey? It's very interesting to see that he goes to both Asia and to Europe. So it's very easy to remember. Remember that Paul's first missionary journey was to Asia, second missionary journey was to Europe, and third missionary journey, he just went back to the same places. He started in Antioch, and then he crossed through Galatia and came to Ephesus. And what we're going to study today is Ephesus, and then he goes, and then he goes into Philippi and all these places. He goes to Corinth, and then he comes back. He comes to Troas, and then takes another route, and then comes down this way through, takes a sea route, and comes to Tyre, and then he comes down to Jerusalem. So, what is important for us at this point is to understand that Paul's first missionary journey, he covered Asia. And in his third missionary journey too, he goes to Asia. There's the first part in Asia, the second part in Europe, and the third is that we study about his return to Jerusalem. So I hope this outline is clear in your mind. And also when you talk about Paul's missionary journey, when it says about the first missionary journey, remember it's Asia. When it says about the second missionary journey, it is going through Asia, but the concentration is Europe. And when he comes back, he comes on the third missionary journey, he comes to Jerusalem. So I'm going to just say some of the unique features of Paul's third missionary journey before we go into it. You should know that it was the longest missionary journey in terms of the geographical area that he covered and the time that he took. This was the longest missionary journey. Third missionary journey was the longest missionary journey. Second thing that we need to understand is that all his missionary journeys, he started from Antioch. The first and the second, he came back to Antioch. That is, he went one round around Asia, the first missionary journey, came back to Antioch. The second missionary journey, he started in Antioch, went through Asia, went to Europe, and then came back to Antioch. But the third missionary journey, he starts from Antioch, but he ends it in Jerusalem. So this is another unique feature of Paul's third missionary journey. The third thing is, in the third missionary journey, as I mentioned to you earlier, Paul visited places he went to. in the first and second journey. He is not venturing into a new area, although as you read, you will find that he has an inclination to go to Rome, but he doesn't do that. Paul visited places he went to in the first and missionary journey, that is Asia and Europe. If somebody wakes you in the middle of the night and asks you, where did Paul go in his first missionary journey? Just say Asia. Second missionary journey? Yeah, Europe. And third missionary journey, he went to both Asia and Europe. What was different? He came back to Jerusalem. He didn't go back to Antioch, but he came back to Jerusalem. And we find that he spent more time in strengthening the churches, the elders, building elders, making disciples, making them rooted in the word of God. He was not more concerned about going and preaching, although he did that, sharing the gospel to pioneering areas. He didn't do that. Rather, he was strengthening the believers and building up the disciples, strengthening the elders in the churches that he had already planted. So these are some unique features about Paul's missionary journey. So we are going to see the first part. The first part of his third missionary journey is Asia. That is Acts chapter 18 verse 23 to chapter 19 verse 41. Now, today we are going to study this Acts chapter 19, and I'm going to give you an outline for Acts chapter 19. So when I put Acts chapter 18, 23 to 19, 41, that is the ending, the last verse in chapter 19 is 41. So we're going to see about 8 points today, and I'm not in a hurry to cover those 8 points. I'll try to be a little slow. Unfortunately, since I'm sharing the screen, I don't see any chat messages. So I don't know how I'm going to read them. Maybe I'll stop sharing in between and then discuss a few things with you. So the first thing that we're going to see is how the missionary journey began. Starting the third missionary journey, we read in Acts chapter 18, verse 23. That is the first point. Then we're going to briefly look into who this person Apollos is. Apollos is mentioned in Acts chapter 18, verses 24 to 28. And with that, we complete Acts chapter 18. And as we begin Acts chapter 19, we begin with the, we see about Ephesus. This is just about an introduction about Acts chapter 19. I'd like to tell why Ephesus is important at this point. Then we come back to studying about, we see in Acts chapter 19, it begins with disciples of John the Baptist and why they are there and what happens with them. We read about them. And then we, interestingly, there is something mentioned about the school of Tyrannus or the hall of Tyrannus. Let's see what that is. We'll try to understand what that is. And after that, we see that there is a conflict with the occult practices of those times. Certain Jews who are having some occult practices, and let's see how Paul, what happens among them. And then we will briefly see what were Paul's ministry plans. He talks about his desire to go into Rome and things like that. And then we finally talk about the riots in Ephesus, and with that we close chapter 19. So this is the outline for chapter, the last part of chapter 18 and chapter 19. So I hope this gives you an outline of what we intend to do in today's Bible study. So the first point is starting the third missionary journey. Now, Acts chapter 18, verse 23 says, after spending some time in Antioch, Paul set out from there and traveled from place to place throughout the region of Galatia, Phrygia, strengthening all the disciples. So what we, after some time, as we saw in the chart, means Paul spent about a year in Antioch. So he was, it's not that he just started the next day or the next week. He almost spent a year in Antioch after his second missionary journey and before he started the third missionary journey. The second thing we read is he traveled through the region of Galatia, Phrygia. These are places that Paul visited during his first missionary journey. And you remember, Galatians is one of the first letters that Paul wrote. We know that it is one of the first. So to give you an idea about what we are talking, we know that Paul visited first in his first missionary journey. He visited Galatia, as we see Galatia right here. And so what I've circled here is what we see as Phrygia. And to give you an idea about how Phrygia looks like, it is something like this. So if this is Galatia, this is Phrygia. So this is the area that is mentioned in Acts chapter 18, verse 23, that he passed through these areas. So this is roughly, just to give you an idea that this is all part of Asia, that is what is mentioned here. And then what was he doing? And according to this verse, very clearly, as we saw, the unique feature of his third missionary journey, as it says in the last part of verse 23, he was strengthening all the disciples. And so he sees the need of discipleship, and that is very, very vital. Very important truth about the New Testament is that, particularly in the life of Jesus' ministry, he never called anyone to become a Christian. If you read the Gospels, at no point Jesus mentioned the word Christian or become a Christian. Rather, Jesus said, come and be my disciples. So the focus of Jesus and the focus of the New Testament is not for us to become good Christians, better Christians, bad Christians, nominal Christians. No, those are not the words that you find in the New Testament. The word that you find in the New Testament is disciple. And it is very important for us to be cautious, to be conscious of this, that we are called to be disciples. And we should be on the road of discipleship, not of becoming good Christians or better Christians. No, that is not the focus. Are you a disciple? We are not going into what are the marks of the disciple or who is a disciple, but I want you to ask yourself, and don't focus on becoming a better Christian. Don't focus becoming a better CSI member or better church member, or but focus on becoming a disciple of Jesus. So having said how the third missionary journey began and what are the areas he was intending to cover, now in Acts chapter 18 verses 24 to 28, you read about this man called Apollos. So what are the things that we read about him? So the first thing is verse 24, a lot of things are told about him in verse 24, but my whole focus is on verse 25, and I'll tell you why. And it says he was a Jew in verse 24. He was a native of Alexandria. Alexandria is in Egypt. So he was from Egypt, and now he is in Ephesus. So he is not in Ephesus for any other reason, but he is there to teach the word of God. And the next thing it says about him is he was a learned man. He was no ordinary man. He has to be mentioned in the Bible. He must have done something remarkable, or he must have been a remarkable person. So it says that he was a learned man. And what is really amazing about him is it says that he was thorough in the knowledge of the scriptures in verse 24. And if you read some other versions, in the version that NASB that I have, it says that he was mighty in the scripture. Amazing. I really wish, it is, I'm telling this from the bottom of my heart, that some of you will be called as people thorough in the knowledge of the scripture. You know, we have experts in every field. We have experts, and when it comes to marketing, we know that this guy is really good at marketing. He knows how to talk. He has the gift of convincing, and he has the capacity to convert things into sales and things. So many things. When you talk about the IT field, we know that certain people are expert in. I don't know that. Some of them say testing and others say programming or whatever it is. We have experts in all fields. And I really wish that some of you be known as this guy is thorough in the knowledge of the scriptures. He knows his scriptures very well. And I like my version which says he was mighty in the scriptures. Man, I would love to see some of you being called as mighty in the scriptures. And this is really, really important for us. And then it goes on to say about Apollos, that Apollos spoke boldly and taught about Jesus accurately. You know, if it has to be mentioned that he was teaching accurately, then we see a small problem. But it says that in verse 25, if you read verse 25, which is up there on the screen, he had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and he spoke with great fervor and taught about Jesus accurately, though he knew only the baptism of John. He knew only the baptism of John, yet he could speak accurately. That is amazing, isn't it? And then Priscilla and Aquila, who were in Ephesus at that time, they found that Apollos needs to know a little more about the scripture. He knows well. He's a learned man. He is thorough in the knowledge of the scriptures, and he preaches boldly. He preaches boldly and accurately, but he needs some fine-tuning. And so we read in verse 26, when Priscilla and Aquila heard of him, they invited him to their home and explained to him the way of God more adequately. You know, another beautiful character about Apollos, he was teachable. Sometimes when we know that we are thorough, we are mighty in the scripture, we should also have the humility to be taught. You know, that is so very important, to be teachable. So Apollos stands as a very good example to follow in the New Testament, and particularly at this time to this group who have committed to studying the Word of God. I know that you are here for this Bible study because you have a love for the Word of God. You want to know the Word of God. And if this Bible study is just giving you a feel-good feeling, you know, that I'm being enlightened about the scriptures, it is a good thing. But I hope that this will provoke you to make your own study of the scriptures. I would say if everyone does it, it's good. But even if some of you do it, and I don't know whom I'm talking to, but then or who this message is for, but I really wish that there will be people who are thorough in the knowledge of the scriptures, who are mighty in the scriptures. And I pray this prayer for all of you who are there. And if you think that this is something that God has been talking to you, this is something that you feel God is leading you into it, pray about it and commit yourself. And if there is any way that I can help you, to guide you how you can get into the study of the scriptures, I'll be very, very happy to do that. And then we go into just giving you a brief idea about Ephesus. Now, let me also make a remark at this time. For all those who are reading, read the Bible, if you notice that today we read Acts chapter 19, and yesterday and today we've been reading the portions that we are actually doing in our Bible study. And I should say, Ben is the one who's sharing the devotions, and he has done an excellent study. And what he says in that brief time is a mine of information. And I wish that you read, hear it again and again. And it is wonderful for me to hear somebody talk about it, and for me to teach the same portion. It's wonderful. So why am I talking about Ephesus? Because I want you to know Acts chapter 19 is all about Ephesus. There is nothing else. Now, Paul comes back to Ephesus. Now, if you read Acts chapter 18, in the second missionary journey, towards the end of second missionary journey, Paul went to Ephesus. And it says, from Athens, he came down to Ephesus. He says, they arrived at Ephesus, where Paul left Priscilla and Aquila. He himself went into the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. When they asked him to spend more time with them, he declined. But as he left, he promised, I will come back if it is God's will. Then he set sail from Ephesus. So remember, this is the background. Paul was in Ephesus, and he was hardly there for a week. During his second missionary journey, that the verse that I just quoted in Acts chapter 18, verse 19 onwards, he was there only for about a week. And what happened in that week? The believers were very keen that Paul spent some more time in Ephesus. They really wanted Paul to stay there and talk to them, and they wanted to have that fellowship with Paul. But he didn't stay. But there's something that he said. He promised to return. He said, if it is God's will, I come back to Ephesus. So as he was planning his missionary journey, what do you think would have been the priority? He said, I'm going to go back to places where I already preached. And he would have said, Ephesus is where I need to spend time. And so we know that Paul's ministry in Ephesus is going to be very special. And in Acts chapter 19, verse 10, this verse that we will come to again, this went on for 2 years so that all the Jews and Greeks who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. What my concern here is about 2 years. We'll come to the Hall of Tyrannus a little later. Paul spent 2 years in one particular place in Ephesus, in the Hall of Tyrannus, teaching the word of God. We'll come to that. So I just want you to keep this, the focus that he is keeping on Ephesus. And a little more interesting, on his return, that is Acts chapter 20, verse 17 to 38, in these verses, you find Paul on his return journey addresses the elders of Ephesus. And in verse 31, in Acts chapter 20, verse 31, it says, Paul says that he was in Ephesus for 3 years. So you now get an idea about Ephesus. Acts chapter 19, Paul, the background is when Paul, at the end of his second missionary journey, hardly stayed there for a week. The believers wanted him to stay there. He said, I am going, but if God wills, I'll come back. In Acts chapter 19, we see that he stayed 2 years. In Acts chapter 20, on his return journey, he says, I stayed there for 3 years. So let's assume that Paul stayed in Ephesus for 3 years. With this, we go into Acts chapter 19. In Acts chapter 19, the first point that we see, that is the fourth point for today's Bible study, is the disciples of John. And verses 1 to 7 is a small description about what happened in Ephesus. Now, the very first verse says that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul took the road through the interior and arrived at Ephesus. There he found some disciples. So, which means Apollos went to Corinth before Paul reached Ephesus. So that's the simple meaning. What we read about Apollos in the last part of Acts chapter 18 is that Apollos was in Ephesus, all about his teaching, and Paul and Priscilla and Aquila correcting him or teaching him is all that is happening in Ephesus. But as before Paul could reach Ephesus, Apollos had already left for Corinth. That is what we understand. Now, according to verse 7, there were 12 disciples of John the Baptist. Now, John the Baptist, we know that he was a leader. He had a following. Some of his disciples became the disciples of Jesus. I'm not going into those details. But we know that he had a following. And probably they didn't know beyond John's baptism. They didn't understand, or they would have known all that happened to Jesus. But they may have still been following the tenets or the principles or the teachings of what John the Baptist was teaching them. And so they were limited, or they thought that they had to limit themselves to that. So here we see that they say that these verses say that verse 7, particularly verse 2 and 4, says that these people, they didn't even know about, or they had not even heard of the Holy Spirit. Now, when you talk about they had not even heard of the Holy Spirit, it doesn't mean that they had not heard about the activities of the Holy Spirit or what happened in Jerusalem. I don't think that is what it means, because we know that there is a considerable presence of the believers in Ephesus. Paul and Priscilla and Aquila have been there for a year, more than a year, that they have been ministering there. So maybe they didn't understand or comprehend what it means to be baptized by the Holy Spirit or be filled with the Holy Spirit. So verse 5 and 6 says they were baptized by Paul. They received the Holy Spirit. They spoke in tongues and they prophesied. So we see that our understanding, sometimes our understanding is limited for our own, for the reasons that is best known to us. We try to limit our understanding about God. We don't want to stretch ourselves, particularly when we talk about the Holy Spirit. If I may go around and ask each one of you, what is your understanding of the Holy Spirit? Some of you may not prefer to talk about the Holy Spirit. We think talking about the Holy Spirit is a controversial subject. No, absolutely not. And this is the process of discipleship. When you begin to understand God in totality, we begin to understand God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Sometimes we are only so keen about understanding what Jesus said. We like to read the Gospels, and particularly we avoid passages that talk about the Holy Spirit. And I think that as we grow, we also need to stretch our understanding, stretch our minds to comprehend, to understand. And particularly, I would invite you to understand the more about the doctrine of the Holy Spirit, what the Bible talks about the Holy Spirit. Make your own study. I'm not saying there are no controversies. People have, if I may use the word, abused the ministry of the Holy Spirit into so many things. And so we need to be very careful. But we should not evade it. We should not avoid it, because Holy Spirit is who lives in us. It is an essential part of us. So let's not become disciples, be like the disciples of John the Baptist, who were kind of narrow in their understanding about the gospel. So let's also begin to stretch our imagination. Now I'm coming to a very important part, that is the we talk about the school of Tyrannus or the hall of Tyrannus. Now this is found in chapter 19 verses 8 to 12. Now let me read that passage for you. Paul entered the synagogue and spoke boldly there for 3 months, arguing persuasively about the kingdom of God. But some of them became obstinate. They refused to believe and publicly maligned the way. So Paul left them. He took the disciples with him and had discussions daily in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. This went on for 2 years, so that the Jews and the Greeks who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. God did extraordinary miracles through Paul, so that even handkerchiefs and aprons that had touched him were taken to the sick, and their illness were cured, and evil spirits left them. So one is, if you read the last part of this passage, the ministry of healing that happened, the miracles that happened were amazing. But even more striking for me is the school of Tyrannus, or the hall of Tyrannus, that is mentioned in verse 9. What is it? Now let's understand what it is very clearly. Now we see that Paul spoke in the synagogue for 3 months. That is what verse 9 says. Paul entered the synagogue and spoke boldly there for 3 months. He was arguing, he was persuading and telling them about the kingdom of God. But you read the response of the Jews. They were not interested. They refused to believe. Rather, they started maligning the way. If you hear today's devotion, Benhur says a good explanation about the way. And they were maligning the disciples, the believers, the church as such. So what does Paul do? Paul thinks, 3 months I've been preaching to them, I've been teaching them, I've been telling them, but these guys are least interested. They don't want to open their thinking caps. They just want to stay where they are. They just don't want to move an inch forward. So what Paul does in verse 9, but some of the second part of verse 9, so Paul left them. He just gave up on them. He took the disciples. I want you to note, he took the disciples with him. These are not the 12 disciples. These are people who are following the way or following Jesus Christ. They're not even the disciples of Paul. They are the disciples of Jesus. He took the disciples with him and had discussions daily in the hall of Tyrannus. For how long? This went on for 2 years. as I was reading this, I thought, you know, how easily I skipped saying that let's not do it every day and let's do it once a week. And I was thinking about the commitment of Paul. Every day for 2 years, he kept teaching them, having discussions with them in the hall of Tyrannus. And I want to share something with you. As when I was studying in the seminary, there was a teacher who would come from the United States, he and his wife, called Charles Corwin. They served as missionaries in Japan, and then he would come to take one course every year, and he would come and teach. I don't remember what was the course he taught, but he would come to our seminary as a visiting professor. And he had a great vision, and something that he started was amazing. In the city of Pune, and he spread that into different parts of India, and I think it's all over the world. He established called the School of Tyrannus. You know what the School of Tyrannus is? He would hire a house in the city of Pune, and he would look for a very committed family who are committed for the ministry, who would like to teach the Word of God, and he would ask them to live in that house. And that house would have several rooms where students, you know, that Pune is the educational capital of Maharashtra, and a lot of universities and colleges. So people from all over India would come and study in Pune. And he would make available rooms for people to come and stay there for 3 years during their study period. And the rule of that house was they can stay there at a very, very affordable cost, very minimum cost. Their food is taken care of, their stay is taken care of. But every morning and evening, particularly every evening, there is a solid Bible study that happens. So over the 3 years or 4 years or 5 years that a person stays in the School of Tyrannus, he not only accomplishes a degree from the university or whatever his professional degree is, he becomes a solid disciple of Jesus. The couple that stays there, their basic responsibility is to teach the small group of people in that house. Maybe a house will have about 7, 8, or 10 people, 10 boys or 10 girls staying in that place. And every evening, they would sit and study the scriptures. Can you imagine the investment that is done into young lives? And these guys who have come through this Tyrannus Hall are all over the world, and they, like Apollos, are mighty in the scriptures. So it's a beautiful ministry. I'm getting a little too excited about the School of Tyrannus, and I don't know if some of you will catch the vision and want to do this. This discussion it was a discussion with the disciples. And I said, this went on for 2 years. Paul was in, what I put in the bracket is that Paul was in Ephesus for 3 years. But out of the 3 years, 2 years every evening, it says discussions daily in the Hall of Tyrannus. That is an amazing commitment. And because of that, what happened? Jews and Greeks in the province of Asia heard the word of God. You know, and not just that, miracles, healing and deliverance. And what were they saying? People would bring handkerchiefs and aprons that had touched, they brought and touched Paul, and they would take it back to the sick, and they would get cured. That was the power of God. And I strongly believe, when the power of God, when the word of God is taught, when the word of God is learned, when we grow in the understanding of God's word, we are further equipped to do the work of God. All of us are called to do miracles, but we are called to be effective people in building the kingdom of God. So friends, I want you to take discipleship very seriously. I want you to think about becoming a disciple, and I want you to think of whether we can make disciples. Okay? So this is one of the focus. I hope you've got this very clear. I'll go to the next point and then take a break. Then we find where the sixth point is that there is a conflict with the occult practices in Acts chapter 19, verse 13 to 20. And all this, mind you, all this is happening in Ephesus. We have not left Ephesus. Paul is in Ephesus. And this gives you also a background when you read the book of Ephesians. So this will help you when you know all this. And further in Acts chapter 21, when we read all that, it will give you a clear understanding as you read the book of Ephesians, letter to Ephesians. Now here, what is this about the occult? Would any of you like to unmute your mic and read this verses 13 to 20?
Ennal deshandrigalai nadakkuna mantravadigalaya chila yahudanmar paulos prasangikkuna yeshuvinte naamathil njan ningalode aanayidunu ennu paranje yeshuvinte naamam choluvan tirinju ingane cheyunnavar mahapurohithanaya സ്ലേവ എന്ന യഹൂദന്റെ ഏഴ് പുത്രന്മാരായിരുന്നു. ദുരാത്മാവ് അവരോട്, യേശുവിനെ ഞാൻ അറിയുന്നു, പൗലോസിനെയും പരിചയമുണ്ട്, എന്നാൽ നിങ്ങൾ ആർ എന്ന് ചോദിച്ചു. പിന്നെ ദുരാത്മാവുള്ള മനുഷ്യൻ അവരുടെ മേൽ ചാടി അവരെ ഇരുവരെയും കീഴടക്കി ജയിക്കിയാൽ അവർ നഗ്നരും മുറിവേറ്റവരുമായി ആ വീട്ടിൽ നിന്ന് ഓടിപ്പോയി. ഇത് എഫേസസിൽ പാർക്കുന്ന സകല യഹൂദന്മാരും യവനന്മാരും അറിഞ്ഞു. അവർക്ക് ഒക്കെയും ഭയം തട്ടി. കർത്താവായ യേശുവിന്റെ നാമം മഹിമപ്പെട്ടു. വിശ്വസിച്ചവരിൽ അനേകരും വന്ന് തങ്ങളുടെ പ്രവൃത്തികളെ ഏറ്റുപറഞ്ഞ് അറിയിച്ചു. ക്ഷുദ്രപ്രയോഗം ചെയ്തിരുന്ന പലരും തങ്ങളുടെ പുസ്തകങ്ങളെ കൊണ്ടുവന്ന് എല്ലാവരും കാണുകയെ ചുട്ടുകളഞ്ഞു. അവയുടെ വില കണക്ക് കൂട്ടിയാലെ 50,000 വെള്ളിക്കാശ് എന്ന് കണ്ടു. ഇങ്ങനെ കർത്താവിന്റെ വചനം ശക്തിയോടെ പരന്ന് പ്രബലപ്പെട്ടു.
നമ്മള് വായിച്ച് കേട്ട we have to connect it to the previous verse, verse 12, where it says that people would bring the handkerchiefs and aprons and then go and touch that to the sick and they would be healed. Now, there were people who were watching this. And remember, those days, occult, evil practices, all these sorceries were very, very common. We've been reading a lot of that in the book of Acts. And they used all the evil spirits to do it. Now, they saw that Paul was driving out, doing all these miracles. And there were Jews also who were, some of the Jews who were into these occult practices, they thought, you know, we can also use the name of Jesus. Now, the point I'd like you to see is the danger of imitation. You know, they just won't, we know earlier we read about Simon the sorcerer who wanted to buy the Holy Spirit. Now here we see about these Jews, and particularly we are talking about, there is a mention about the seven sons of Sceva and a Jewish chief priest, you know, and the chief priest's sons themselves were doing this occult practices, and they tried to use the name of Jesus. And you know, very interestingly, as you read verse 14, or verse 15, one day the evil spirit answered. When they were trying to drive out, these people were driving out the evil spirit, trying to use the name of Jesus. So the evil spirit talks back and says, Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but who are you? And then it says, the evil spirit overpowered them, gave them such a beating that they ran out of their house naked and bleeding. This is what happens when we try to use the name of the Lord in vain. You remember the commandment of God? Don't ever take the name of God in vain. In whatever discussions, whatever arguments, whatever you say about God, don't make God as something very ordinary for us to talk about or to do anything that we like. So there is a danger in imitation, in what these people were trying to do. But what happens? You know, even if the name of the Lord is misused, what happens? You see God's mysterious power. Verse 16, you know, when they ran out bleeding and all that, verse 17 says, when this became known to the Jews and Greeks living in Ephesus, they were all seized with fear, and the name of the Lord was held in high honor. Don't ever think, or you may be upset when people misuse the name of the Lord. They may take the name of the Lord for granted, or sometimes misuse it or abuse it. But remember, the name of the Lord is above every other name. There is nothing, no evil or human effort, initiative can malign the name of the Lord. When people do that, His name is held in great high, in high honor. Okay, and then it says in verse 18, which we go to is, there's conversion and growth. Many of those who believed now came openly and confessed what they had done. There is conversion. People are repenting. What are they doing? A number of who had practiced sorcery brought their scrolls together and burned them publicly. You know, there is repentance. As Jesus said, when you lift my name, I will draw all men unto me. We need to lift the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus is so powerful. It's so wonderful. And in this way, the word of the Lord spread widely and grew in power. There is growth. It always happens. I have two small points, and it's 8:30. I think I don't want to push it through. I'll stop here, and I'll keep this for the next class. And this is my takeaway for today. I want you to think about this. Mission is becoming and developing experts in the scripture. It's my sincere prayer, and I want to be very frank about it. I'm really praying that some of you become and develop experts in the scripture. You first become an expert in the scripture. Don't think it is someone else. Maybe God may call you to do this. And all of us can, not for the sake of earning a title like that, but have a heart that I want to learn the scripture. I want to know the scripture. God bless you all.